involved this morning, and as we move forward in the next couple of months, this will become clear whether Zimbabwe is going to be a democratic developmental state or is going to be a developmental democratic state. So my theme, my talk was to talk about the role of development and technical partners in the new Zimbabwe. So the first question I'd like to know is, who are these partners? It's a bit boring, but I'm a bureaucrat. Now I'm a student of innovation, and I think I'm a student of, not transformation, sir, transitions. Watching how societies change, and quite often being thrown in the mix in terms of understanding and participating, and making mistakes, and learning from it. So there are two types of basic development partners if you have to divide them. There's the multilateral, and there Zimbabwe is a member with other countries. So it's not an external relationship, it's an internal relationship Zimbabwe has got. Zimbabwe is a member of the multilateral institutions. So it's not a relation with outsiders, it's a relation with partners within a framework defined by the international organization. The second one is bilateral partners, where Zimbabwe is in a relationship with another country. That one is a much more like shaking hands. It's not holding shoulders, working together, it's more shaking hands. You're on one side, I'm on the other side. We're figuring out how we negotiate. Then they talked about technical partners in this topic. I didn't select the topic, but I'm a very good bureaucrat, so I tend to follow what I'm asked to do. So the technical partners, they are the UN agencies mainly. And these are the WHO, the UNICEF, the UNESCO, the ANTAD. Those are generally technical partners, and they operate within the multilateral framework. But nevertheless, they are given a certain level of autonomy in order to actually provide technical assistance, not just to developing countries, but to the whole world. To every country, whether you are developed or industrialized, or industrialized, you qualify for technical assistance from these technical partners. Then you've got the aid agencies. These are the ones representing governments, which fall in the bilateral. They are technical in the sense that they also provide technical assistance. A lot of them, out of the colonial encounter, out of the end of the colonial era, they left, you know, countries they felt were technically low capacities. So aid agencies were set up to try and help these countries at least figure out the developmental agenda, especially in the economic and social spheres. They tend to be the bilateral kind of agencies, the DFIDs, the USAIDs, the old CEDAWs, the NORADs, and JICAs. And we have all of them. So these are the kind of they provide technical, first and foremost, they see themselves as technical, and then as financial. Then you've got the development banks. These are international and regional. So you've got the international financial institutions, the World Banks, you've got the IMFs, you've got the European Development Bank. And you've got the other banks that regional, the African Development Bank, the Asian Development Bank. And then finally, you've got the investment firms. These are usually privately owned, but progressively, especially in the developmental state, we are seeing both private and public funding in these kind of investment funds. And they are becoming the biggest sources of funding world that we find ourselves in. So that is the one of the boring part of at least setting the context of understanding this idea of development partners and technical partners. The talk is about taking Zimbabwe forward. Now, to take Zimbabwe forward, there's a sense of movement. So the question is, what are the preconditions for movement? One is knowing where you are. Two is knowing where you have been. And three is knowing where you want to go. So those are the three questions I think you're going to talk about moving to Zimbabwe forward. You have to ask yourself, where have we been, where are we, and where do we want to go? So where is Zimbabwe today? In terms of development partner, not the political side, I'm only here to talk about economics. The politics I need to report and others. Zimbabwe, how it is today in terms of developmental, in the way it relates to development partners, in the way I define them above, is that it is receiving limited humanitarian assistance from predominantly industrialized countries using UN technical agencies. That's why we find ourselves today. Two, we find ourselves reasonably highly indebted to all the major development banks, international financial institutions, and investment banks. That includes people like KfW of Germany, European Bank, and others. And we have defaulted in arrears, and we are in arrears. So we defaulted on our loans, we didn't pay the interest, we didn't pay, and we are defaulted. Thirdly, we find ourselves attracting low domestic and international investments. Fourthly, we are experiencing low productivity in the economy, whether it's in agriculture, mining, manufacturing in particular, or even sometimes in the service sector, although I think the service sectors, things in Zimbabwe is not doing too bad. But I think suddenly we have very low productivity in the main economy, in the main sectors of the economy of agriculture, mining, and manufacturing. We also find ourselves spending more than we are, with a growing budget deficit. The old idea of BT, we eat what we kill, we threw that out the window, we eat what we need, we eat what we want. The problem with that is that when you do that, you have $10 and you spend $100. Either you borrow the 90, you steal it. However you get it, you will spend it. But at the moment, we find ourselves, and then if you have the state machinery, you create virtual money, and therefore you can continue spending, although you really don't have the money to spend. We find ourselves experiencing low liquidity, which is associated with high deficit. And this is primarily because we want to avoid hyperinflation. When you spend more money than you have, one way to get rid of the liquidity is print. Then you get rid of the, you sort out the liquidity problem, but then you create hyperinflation. And we've been through here, those of us, I arrived here in August 2007, and my third day, I think it's the third day or second day, gone and knocked off three zeros from my money. And I go back to Washington, people say, what happened? I say, well, I go there, my 1,000 became $1. What did you do? What could I do? So we find ourselves in a situation where we know where we come from today. So we are not problem, but the one of the easiest routes available is printing more money. Because if you do, then you will drive hyperinflation. You know what hyperinflation does to everybody, whether you are rich or poor, it doesn't really matter. We also find ourselves in the midst of very highly positive atmosphere and goodwill. And that, I think, is something that you said, I've talked about. And this is both local and international, to a new government. Whether you call it new government, a renewed government, a changing government, it doesn't matter, it is new. Change is the movement, it's a process of moving forward. And there is definitely a sense that we are moving forward. So there's a lot of goodwill, both locally and internationally and regionally. And suddenly the citizens feel a certain warmth towards their state and their government, feeling we are on the road to somewhere. So the idea of this conversation that taking Zimbabwe forward, I think majority of Zimbabweans will say we agree the mood is one of how we go forward. And finally, where we are faced with very high expectations from our population who are seeking improvements in the economic fortunes. And it, to me, it is those last 2 points. You've got goodwill, both national and international. You've also got very high expectation for population that might necessarily look patient now. We're never sure how long they will be patient. Population, human beings are not very patient when it comes to wanting change, especially when they see change happening. So where we are now, that is why I think, in my view, from a development point of view, in setting up the scene for discussing development partners and partners. That's why I think we are, and that is the environment we are to play. So where have we come from? We have come from, and again, this is only where we come from with respect to development partners and technical partners. We have come from a prolonged standoff between Zimbabwe government and some of the international players over issues of policy position. There have been disagreements on policy position, principally over property rights and concerns over what many of the international partners call democratic deficit. And that has been some of the international development partners, international, you know, whether they are partners, sometimes regional and national too, they feel that two areas of property rights and what we call democratic deficit, the standoff has been prolonged. Secondly, we come from a background of big gaps between policy statements and intention. What the government says they intend to do, what policies they state they wish to pursue on the one hand, and policy follow through, i.e. implementation on the other. To me, from a partner's point of view, those are the two parameters I would suggest. If you're going to look, try to understand where the partners, where the development partners or technical partners, what is going to bring them to the table, is those two issues. Can we overcome the standoff, property rights, and democratic deficit issues? Can we overcome the difficulty, the gap between what the government says they wish to do, what they state they are going to do, and what they actually do? Two, the government plans to compensate white farmers. The outgoing government said they were willing to compensate white farmers. They set out their conditions. The conditions were inappropriate or unacceptable to the white farmers and an economy that couldn't bear it. We still haven't seen the terms of this, but at least the principle has been restated that although the land reform is inevitable, was inevitable, it's irreversible, there is a desire and intention to compensate white farmers, obviously within the availability of means. We all know what happened when he compensated the war veterans in 1998. So clearly, the compensation of white farmers has been in the context of what is fiscally responsible and sustainable. You don't compensate one group to destroy the other. So that's going to be a challenge, and I think we're going to be developing partners, whether they are both technical or development, we're going to be watching out what that means. Three, and this is important, he thinks the international community, both domestic and international, need to understand that they are all going to be strong pillars, democracy, and they are necessary. This is what I'm taking it from what he said. I can only take it from what the first citizen says are the intention, the person we put in charge to lead the state, The strong pillars of democracy are necessary. Fourthly, debts need to be sustainable, serviced, and settled. There are no big debts. 10 to 15 billion dollars. It's a lot of money, but it's also not a lot of money. If I tell you you're going to pay a cup of coffee for $3 down at the coffee shop here, most of you will say, oh, you wouldn't even think about it. If I go to Highfields and tell somebody you're going to pay a cup of tea $3, they're going to look at me and say, what? So whether it's a lot of money or not a lot of money depends on your situation. Facebook is worth nearly $500 billion. That's a lot of money. So 10 or 15 billion dollars, not a lot of money. It depends on what it is you are, what your income is, and what you are putting on the table. So if you are in debt, and you are a doctor, medical doctor, I assume there's a medical doctor in the room, he owes $1,000 to the bank. Then there is this trader from Bali, he owes $1,000, actually he owns $100 from. To use $100 in the bank. You both go to see their banker and say, I wish to make arrangement to pay you. And the banker says, what are your plans? I'm going to get a job. The doctor says, you as a doctor, you're getting a job? Yeah, I'm getting a job at the Avenue Clinic. Oh, sure, sign up here, I know you pay. The poor guy walks in and owns $100, says, I'm going to get a job. What? I'm going to be pushing my cart in the city center to actually sell apples. Come back in a week's time and see whether you can pay this debt. So it's not a lot of money. It is a lot of money if you ask what you do. And finally, he said, his government's intention is to create jobs. No one can argue with that agenda. I certainly can't. And I think most Zimbabweans will not argue, and I think most international communities won't disagree, whether they are partners or technical or governmental. why do development partners and technical partners want to get involved in Zimbabwe? And this is where I want to leave, because I think this is a discussion, I think in the conversation, we need at least to explore and ask ourselves a few hard questions. Development technical partners justify their involvement in any country on the need to do two things. One is to support economic growth that brings benefits to the population. Because you saw what happened in the First World War and Second World War, where citizens are unhappy that the economic conditions are getting better, and the leaders are busy trying to make sure they get more resources for their citizens, and they go to war. So at least that's the theory of why development partners and technical partners get into it. One is they want to support economic growth and that brings benefits to the population. Secondly, is to bring relief to the underserved and underprivileged. That is the main argument about development partners getting involved coming to the table. On the other hand, investment partners generally justify their involvement on account of potential returns to their investment. They don't come here because they love you. They come here because they think if I invest a dollar, I might get $2. And your job is to say, well, you invest a dollar, you can make $1.25. Well, elsewhere you make $1.10, so Zimbabwe is a reasonable place, and we'll let you take your 25 cents out. We'll not let you take $2 because we think that is too much, therefore we negotiate how much you make. But therefore, the technical partner, the investment partner is going to be coming here, not the development ones, the technical ones, they come because they want a return on their investment, a fair return on investment. And that is comparable. If I'm getting 3% for my money, putting it in London and Washington, and you give me 10%, I will be happy to invest. As long as I can take my 10% out. You can make it 30%, but I'll make my 10%. Now, we find that we are ourselves in a new situation. Because with the rapid growth of BRICS, Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa, led by China, combined with the modest growth in the economies of traditional Western donor countries, we find ourselves in a situation whereby bilateral funding has become more important than multilateral sources of finance. That is, the financing from the World Bank and the IMF has become less important than the money that comes from the bilaterals, whether it's the China Development Bank or whether it is from EFID or from USAID. That in relative terms, that is a lot more money. But it dwindles into insignificance compared to the amount of money coming from investment firms, people who have invested their private capital. Development aid has become a very small part of that process. This is new, and it has implications for states and governments. Therefore, there is a shift from the idea for development partners to one of partners in development. That the private sector comes here and says, I'm not here, I'm not a development partner, but I'm a partner with you in development. We are partners to develop the Lupane coal business in the case. We are going to be partners in developing the Zanu-PF power station. We're going to be partners in developing the water dam here in Tokomokosu. I am not a development partner, I'm a partner in your development. That distinction, and the partners in development are becoming more important than development partners, if you accept my definition, or that definition that is emerging. It's sustainable, it has to be serviceable, and it has to be serviceable. Otherwise, Zimbabwe being a member of the multilateral institutions, which is a member shoulder to shoulder, will be breaking the rules on which it's signed up to. And no one should be lent international money and allowed to get away without being held to account for what they do. But then it's a very complicated process. In the 70s, suddenly aid and trade were considered dirty words. You could not say aid and trade in the same word and get away with it. Now, you almost will not get away with this if you don't talk about aid and trade. There are two major implications arising from this shift. In terms of for traditional and aid recipient government. At a government like Zimbabwe, there are two major implications I see. One, there is a need to develop greater internal capacities, that is Zimbabwe's internal capacities, to manage development projects, and that includes setting its own priorities, planning those projects, negotiating, implementation, and accountability. And that is the experience we have across Africa, across Asia, and across Latin America in the last 15 years. That the capacity of national governments, it becomes critically important for you to say, this is our priority. This is what we plan to do with it. We are willing to negotiate around the table and negotiate hard. We are willing to take responsibility for implementation, and we shall remain accountable for what we produce. That's one implication that I think Zimbabwe, in the new Zimbabwe, this has to sink very hard and very quickly. The second one is the need, the urgency to create conditions for citizens. And this I want to emphasize citizens. I'm supposed to talk about development partners and technical partners. Citizens, creating conditions for citizens and commercial enterprises across the board, both private and public. And this is important if you're going to talk about developmental state, developmental, democratic state. The conditions for citizens and commercial enterprises, both private and public, to engage in activities for profit, not for charity, for profit. What are the implications of this movement away from a dependent state to a developmental state, which is also ideally democratic? I have a few points. The foundation for this environment, that is, you want to move from a dependent state, which is, remember, Gunda Frank, the dependency debate in Latin America, what Rodney Howe, Europe developed Africa, underdeveloped Africa. If you're going to move from the idea that Africa and Zimbabwe, and you are a late comer to the new post-colonial, post-one-party state, post-democratic discussions, if you're going to move from that to the developmental and ideally democratic state, the foundation for this environment, which is dominated by democratic states, which is also developmental, is a facilitation of three basic freedoms. One, political freedoms. And that people talked about. It's for citizens to associate and select representatives. That's standard democracy. Second freedom is economic freedom, for citizens to produce and engage in commerce, which is the developmental element of it. And third freedom is the freedom from grinding poverty. It's not enough for me to vote. It's not enough for me to go and trade. Before I earn 1 cent, and in the evening I live in grinding poverty, my children can't go to school, they can't study. Therefore, I need the freedom to be able to have the freedom for citizens to associate select representative. I want the freedom to be able to engage in commerce. And I want freedom to be for my family and myself to be free from grinding poverty. And therefore, this is in order to make sure that it's stated in the form that we make sure people have food, they have reasonable health, they have reasonable water, they have means of sanitation, and they have other services, which then has the idea of an inclusive dimension. So these freedoms are talking to the democratic element, the developmental element, and the inclusivity dimension. So those three freedoms are citizen demanding, not just in Zimbabwe, but across all societies, even in the UK, even in Donald Trump's America, even in China. Around the world, those are the three freedoms the citizens are demanding. We want to be free to associate and to elect. We want the freedom to be able to actually get around my businesses and in commerce. And I want the freedom to say, I am no longer living credit poverty when my next door neighbor is actually wallowing in champagne bottles and washing their feet in champagne when I can't even get my checkbook. Therefore, expectations are that the changing Zimbabwe, I call it changing Zimbabwe, and I agree with people, it's a changing Zimbabwe. The changing Zimbabwe government will in this regard tackle four key issues. And now I'm coming to the conclusion. One, bring finality to stability in property rights, both agrarian and indigenization, within a democratic and developmental framework that fosters economic growth. We have to bring a finality to those two. Two, is to implement policies that facilitate domestic investments. Domestic investment, you sitting here, if you cannot be persuaded to invest in Zimbabwe, why should I afford it? So the first thing, they have to implement policies that facilitate the domestic investors and attract foreign investment first, that they are diaspora, and then other partners who we are calling the investors as partners and technical partners. Three, allow citizens to engage in trade and commerce without policy or bureaucratic hindrances to underpin the developmental democratic nature of the economy. That if I cannot engage in commerce without being hindered by bureaucratic and policy hindrances, then how can you say I'm in a democratic developmental state? And finally, implement a safety net program targeted at the poor and vulnerable to foster greater inclusivity, something that Reverend Tati and I had cause to discuss last week. Therefore, in conclusion, it is fair to say that in view of the above remarks I've made, partners in development, i.e. citizens, private companies, public agencies like your state-owned enterprises, and governments across the world and in Zimbabwe, are waiting for the Zimbabwe government to articulate its plan, which must have measured milestones, and then demonstrate implementation progress in a way that reconciles the demands of citizens and commerce with those of the state. It is this, make sure that you maintain a balance, a healthy balance, between what the citizens and those in commerce are demanding and what the state is also demanding. I think if you can, if the Zimbabwe government can attain that balance, then I would say that these partners in development are ready to come to the party. Thank you.
For these and other stories, visit our website www.263chat.com. Follow us on Twitter @263chat and like our Facebook page, 263chat.